full of water. Who's that yonder dressed in red, wade in the water? Must be the children that Moses led, and God's gonna trouble the water.
Good morning, St. Matthews. Welcome to your online Sunday service. This is Youth Sunday. We love our young adults here at St. Matthews. Our high school people are preparing with excitement for their pilgrimage to Ireland in June, but they are taking time today to serve us as ushers, readers, and chalice bearers in the in-person services, and you may hear some of them in this service as readers. And in July, when they come back from Ireland, we will have another Youth Sunday to hear them share their experiences with us. Our preacher this morning is the Reverend Andrea White. Andrea is a priest of the church and, in retirement, a regular member of St. Matthew's Choir. So we appreciate her stepping over to the pulpit this morning to break God's word for us. Yesterday at Trinity Cathedral in Phoenix, 10 members of St. Matthew's were confirmed and received as Episcopalians. It was a wonderful moment. It's a wonderful moment in one's spiritual life to confirm our baptismal vows as Christians and to affirm that this is the branch of Christ Church we feel called to live out our Christian service in. The Feast of Pentecost is coming up 3 weeks from today. We'd like to have you speak a few lines of the Pentecost Gospel in a foreign language that you know. Do contact Darlene Abel or me this week so we can get you set to present part of the gospel on Pentecost. Let's take a minute and draw a breath, say a prayer as we prepare for our worship. Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, who truly to know is everlasting life, grant us so perfectly to know your Son Jesus to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from Acts. Now the apostles and the believers who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also accepted the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him, saying, "Why did you go to the uncircumcised men and eat with them?" Then Peter began to explain it to them, step by step, saying, "I was in the city of Joppa praying. In a trance, I saw a vision. There was something like a large sheet coming down from heaven, being loaded by its four corners, and it came close to me. As I looked at it closely, I saw four-footed animals, beasts of prey, reptiles, and birds of air. I also heard a voice saying to me, 'Get up, Peter, kill and eat. But I replied, "By no means. Lord, for nothing profane or unclean has ever entered my mouth." But a second time the voice answered from heaven, "What God has made clean, you must not call profane." This happened three times, and everything was pulled up again to heaven. At that very moment, three men sent to me from Caesarea arrived at the house where we were. The Spirit told me to go with them and not make a distinction between them and us. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen the angel standing in his house and saying, "Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will give you a message by which you and your entire household will be saved." And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them just as it had upon us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said, "John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." If then God gave them the same gift that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could hinder God? When they heard this, they were silenced. And they praised God, saying, "Then God has given even to the Gentiles the repentance that leads to life." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the highest. Praise him, all you angels of his. Praise him, all his hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, heaven of heavens, and you waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded, and they were created. He made them stand fast forever and ever. He gave them a law which shall not pass away. Praise the Lord from the earth, you sea monsters and all deeps, fire and hail, snow and fog, tempestuous wind, doing his will, mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild beasts and all cattle, creeping things and winged birds, kings of the earth and all people, and princes and all rulers of the world, young men and maidens, old and young together, let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name only is exalted. His splendor is over earth and heaven. He has raised up strength for his people and praise for all his loyal servants, the children of Israel, a people who are near him. Hallelujah.
I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned from her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also, he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." Here it is saying to God's people.
I The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. At the Last Supper, when Judas had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Good morning, St. Matthews. If you knew that your days were numbered, what would your last words be? Have you ever thought about that? I'm venturing a guess, but for me, those words would be an expression of gratitude and especially of love. I thought about that as I was reading through John's Gospel for the last few weeks. Jesus knew he didn't have much longer to live. He had a lot of last words for the disciples. These words today, though, I believe were some of the most important because these last words were an expression of love. Just as he loved them, they are to love one another. John calls it a commandment. When Jesus says these words, he is saying so much more. It's something deeper, richer, larger than simply loving one another. The lectionary reading today takes us back to a pivotal point in the Gospel of John. And it seems like we've heard this reading before, and we have recently, though an expanded version on Maundy Thursday, for those who were here. These words from Jesus are part of Jesus' farewell discourse and final instructions to the disciples present at the final hours they have with him. They've had their meal together. Jesus has washed their feet. Judas has left and gone to betray Jesus. And now to those remaining, he tells them to choose love. More specifically, to love one another as he has loved them, for that will be the mark of a disciple, that they have loved one another. Our passages this week, certainly from John and even from Acts, strongly suggest that an appropriate post-resurrection life motto is choose love. But that can be an awfully hard thing to do. And why is that? Before I reflect on that question, I want to say that music is what speaks deeply to me. That's part of the reason I'm in the choir. Two songs or compositions come to mind when I think about choosing love. First is "If Ye Love Me," a piece by Thomas Tallis that we sang on Maundy Thursday. The other is by a more modern composer, Mark Miller. His piece is titled, "I Choose Love." Ever since I learned this piece many years ago, I come back to it again and again because of how powerful the words are. Maybe sometime the choir will sing it for you. Deep down, I believe we usually know what is the most loving thing to do for one another. Yet doing it is another matter. Lots of things get in the way. How love seems to work in our world is determined by how worthy, how deserving we think a person is. Are we taking too much of a chance investing our time and efforts in certain people? Do we expect something in return? In a world that values agreements, securities, sureties, warranties, and contracts, in a world that has as its motto, quid pro quo, to love without a guarantee is a commandment that seems almost impossible to obey. The kind of love Jesus commends to his followers is, of course, the self-sacrificial love he has shown in his formation of them into a community of believers, as well as the supreme form of self-giving that he is about to display in his passion and death for them and for the whole world. The disciples were commanded to choose love in the aftermath of betrayal and in the midst of uncertainty. This is what, by this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. That's what that means. This is the kind of love Jesus is asking us to live, not for guarantees, not for reciprocity, not for assurances, but for the sake of a different way to see and live in the world. And the reason? So that the world can come a little closer to knowing God's love. In the season of Easter, every Sunday as we read through the stories in Acts, we hear of the disagreements, struggles, challenges, and joys of an early community of Christians being formed and shaped, learning to live out their understandings of what Jesus taught them about love, about a mutual affection and community. I can't help thinking of Peter in Acts today speaking about his experience. Peter has a vision and a revelation that pushes him beyond his comfort zone and expands his understanding about who is included in God's all-embracing love. He says, "If then God gave them, the Gentiles, the same gift, that is, the gift of the Holy Spirit, that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could hinder God?" It's a good question, one I've asked myself, or one I've had to ask myself. How often do I try and hinder God in the way that I act and think? Like anything, for Peter, questions still came up, and there were rocky times ahead, and there still are for us too. Recently, I have been reading our presiding bishop Michael Curry's book, The Way of Love, a book I not only highly recommend, but encourage everyone to read. Those of you who have participated in Becoming Beloved Community sessions here at St. Matthew's, and anyone who has heard our presiding bishop speak or preach, know how much emphasis he places on love and the way of love, and the way of love teaches. Often and in many ways, he says, for those who truly believe in the beloved community is what the movement to get there needs to look like. Or, he says, put more simply, the path to love needs to look like love. In the book, through his many personal life stories and experiences, he tackles and reflects on 10 difficult questions, ones he's been asked many times by many people. In no way is Bishop Curry naive about the difficulty and pain that sometimes arises when we commit to walk with each other as brothers and sisters in Christ, in the way of love that Jesus taught and lived. Can it work? He is often asked. Is the way of love effective as a way to change this world we are living in today? After a great deal of reflection, his answer to these questions are, not only will it work, it's the only thing that will work. A skeptical journalist once said to him, "Sounds nice, but isn't a world built on love utopian? Maybe a little Pollyannish?" To which he shot back, "How is the way of the world working for you right now? Who's the Pollyanna here?" So if these questions have come up for you too, then for sure read Bishop Curry's book. I could go on and on about this book because it's filled with wisdom and heartfelt stories and reflections, and it is enlightening. He doesn't leave out his struggles and challenges. Rest assured, the book is far from Pollyannish. What I have learned over the years is that it is imperative that we engage with others different from ourselves in more than superficial ways. And most of the time, it will not happen when us keeps our distance from them. We must as well put aside any belief in our superiority over others. That is, if we choose to get too close, live too close, interact too much, we risk contamination and becoming unclean too. Well, if Peter can do it, then I suppose I can as well. Sometimes our self-definition is constructed upon differentiating ourselves from others instead of upon who we are in God, who we all are in God. So what I'm trying to say here is when you love, you can more easily see that love surrounds you. When you love, you can more readily recognize acts of love. When you love, you can more clearly sense expressions of love. Love can often be overlooked, taken for granted, dismissed as just an act of kindness when you're not used to living in love. To choose love is doing it, looking for it, and naming it. It is living a life that loves unconditionally and calls attention to the love you receive, love you can never repay, and, well, that's the point. What I hope you'll remember today is, first of all, to recognize that love is not merely a sentiment. Love is a choice. Love is an action. It is, in fact, the only thing that has ever changed the world for the better. There are more stories and examples that I could possibly remember or recall, and I'm sure you know some of them, people who have changed the world in big ways. And small ways too. Even in the midst of pain, the way of love is the only choice. Because if we follow Jesus, we know that Jesus knew that choosing love changes us, changes our world, besides being good for the soul. I too believe, as Bishop Curry, that people want to model another way of being for the world. A world where human kindness, compassion, and justice for all will prevail, because it is God's way. There are many ways to be an instrument of love. Reflect on that this week. How am I living and practicing the way of love in my life, here and now? And read Bishop Curry's book when you have some time. Learning and committing to the way of love and practicing it in our lives, that is what will make a future possible for all God's children. May not be easy, however, it is within our power to transform, to fashion a world, a country, a community, a neighborhood, a family, where there is genuine love and affection for one another, where people are concerned about the well-being of all people. We just have to believe and do it one step at a time. Amen.
Please join me in reading the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit he became incarnate with the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You opened Peter to a new and inclusive insight into your work, O God, and through him, changed the hearts and minds of the early church. Help us see your Spirit moving among those who are as Gentiles to us, that we may share in the repentance that leads to life. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise the Lord from the heights. Grant us a vision of the new Jerusalem when you shall dwell in the midst of all peoples, wiping away every tear and putting behind the former times of division and separation. Praise God, sun and moon. Praise God, all you shining stars. We intercede for these United States entrusted to our care, and for our President, Congress, and Supreme Court. Teach us to walk justly, to care for the poor and oppressed, and to labor for the increase of those freedoms given from your hand. Let us praise the name of the Lord, for we are created. Show us our duties as stewards of the earth and guardians of its bounty, restraining our excess, that the environment may prosper and all people share in your abundance. Mountains and hills, fruit trees and all cedars, praise the Lord. Teach us to wonder at all creation and to direct our hearts to you in worship. Fire and hail, snow and fog, tempestuous winds, doing God's will. Be with our sick and downcast, and especially those for whom we now pray, that they might learn again your loving care. God, raise up strength for the people. Inscribe your new commandment into our minds and hearts, that we might love one another as you have loved us, and that our love would be so sure we would be known as your disciples. Let us praise the name of the Lord, for God's name only is exalted.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you." Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us that peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign now and forever. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins, through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Thank you.
There's a kind of thing that just breaks a man. Breaking down to his knees. God, I've broken more than a time or two. Yes, Lord, then he picked me up. Show me what it was to be a man. Come on and sing now.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours. Now and forever. Amen. May Almighty God, who has redeemed us and made us his children through the resurrection of his Son, our Lord, bestow upon you the riches of his blessing. May God, who through the water of baptism has raised us from sin into newness of life, make you holy and worthy to be united with Christ forever. May God, who brought us out of bondage to sin into true and lasting freedom in the Redeemer, bring you to your eternal inheritance. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Lord, for the small things, like me and her on the porch swing, the summer nights, the fireflies, and the sound of my old six string. Blessings on blessings on blessings on blessings, if I still got breath in these lungs. That's all I need to get down on my knees and be thankful for all that he's done. For my mama, for my friends, for the love that never ends, for the songs that make us dance on the soldier. Thank you, Lord, for the hard times, the light in the way in the dark times, for pulling me in, forgiving again, the times that I took it too far. Gotta thank you for keeping me humble, so picking me up when I stumble. And although I changed, you stayed the same, and I don't say thank you enough. For my mama, for my friends, for the love that never ends, for the songs that make us dance on the soldier floor.
Thank you, Lord. Raise up eyes closed. One thing I know. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Raise up eyes closed. One thing I know. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Raise up eyes closed. One thing I know. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. want to thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord.